Hello, my name is Philippe Burin. I am a professor in the history department at McNeese State University.
And I'm Sarah Lognion. I'm from the history department at McNeese. Welcome to Your Grandma Rocks, where we explore the lives of famous women in history.
Welcome and bienvenue à nos amis francophones. Vous écoutez la radio de l'Université McNeese.
On the program today, music and history as we retrace the life of a remarkable woman.
Well, you are the one who did the research for today's show, so you tell us, who was this woman?
I'll give you a clue. A novelty board game was inspired by her trip around the world.
Well, that makes me think about Phileas Fogg, the hero of that novel by Jules Verne, Around the World in 80 Days, but Phileas Fogg was a man, whereas we only cover women in the show, not to mention he was fictional, so I guess not him.
You're not far. Today's woman was inspired by this novel to do a real trip around the world, which she finished in less than 80 days, by the way. She was also a famous novelist herself, and a journalist, and an inventor. Her name was Nellie Bly.
I heard of her. A student of mine once did a project on that one time where Nellie Bly pretended to be crazy so that she could investigate an insane asylum. Well, that should be interesting. But first, we always start with a song. So what do you have in store for us?
We'll start with You Belong to Me by Patsy Cline.
See the pyramids along the Nile. Watch the sunrise on a tropic isle. Just remember, darling, all the while, you belong to me. See the marketplace Algiers, send me photographs and souvenirs. Just remember, when a dream appears, you belong to me. I'll be so alone without with rain. Just remember, till you're home again, you belong to me. I'm gonna be so alone without you. Just remember, till you're home again, you belong to me.
Bonjour and welcome back to Your Grandma Rocks. We just listened to You Belong to Me by Patsy Cline. Je m'appelle Philippe Girard.
And I'm Sarah. Today we're exploring the life of famed investigative journalist, world traveler, and inventor Nellie Bly.
Nellie Bly. That has a nice ring to it. Very catchy name.
Actually, she was not always known as Nellie Bly. She was born Elizabeth Jane Cochran in 1864 near Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
She was a daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Cochran, I assume?
Yes, her father was a mill worker who had a lot of children. 10 with his first wife, and another 5 with his second. Nellie Bly was child number 13. Her nickname was Pink, by the way, because she loved that color.
13th child. Wow. So, what led her to become an investigative journalist? Because being born to a mill worker with a huge family is not exactly a great springboard for a career, especially since many women did not have a career at all outside the home in the 19th century.
In 1885, when Cochrane was 21 years old, a misogynist article titled, What Girls Are Good For, appeared in the Pittsburgh Dispatch. The article argued that women were only good at being homemakers and mothers.
Well, that would be par for the course for the time. This was an era when most women still did not have the right to vote, so homemakers it was. So I assume that Nellie Bly did not agree, right?
No. She wrote a rebuttal under the pseudonym Lonely Orphan Girl. The editor of the Dispatch was so impressed that he hired her to write for the paper.
Elizabeth Cochrane, and then Pink, her nickname, and then now Lonely Orphan Girl. Well, she went through a lot of names in her lifetime.
In case you were wondering about the origin of her pen name, Cochrane chose Nellie Bly from a song by Stephen Foster. It was a popular folk song during Bly's lifetime.
Well, we listened to music on that show, so maybe we could listen to that song right now.
I'm sort of reluctant to include it, though, considering the history of the song itself. I find it degrading and a bit racist that the original song was written by Stephen Foster, a white man about an African-American woman, and it is sung in African-American dialect.
I understand your concern, but, you know, as historians, we cannot bury our head in the sand and completely ignore uncomfortable aspects of the past just because they are uncomfortable. But I have good news for you. There is a later remade version that is a bit more suitable for modern-day audiences, and that's the one that we will sample now.
Welcome back. I'm Sarah, co-host of Your Grandma Rocks, your favorite women's history show on KBYS.
Et je suis Philippe Chirin, vous écoutez la radio de l'Université McNeese. We just listened to the song Nellie Bly by Stephen Foster, because that is the song that gave today's person of interest, Nellie Bly, her name.
Indeed. Today we are exploring the life of the American investigative journalist Nellie Bly.
So let's pick up the story from where we left off. Before our break, you were telling us how she began her career as a journalist when she was still a young woman.
Yes. While still 21 years old, Bly was still, to use her own words, determined to do something no girl has done before. So she got an assignment as a foreign correspondent in Mexico.
Okay, let's see. She was 21 years old. She was born in 1864, so that puts us in 1885. Well, that would be right in the middle of the dictatorship of Porfirio Diaz. And if you're not too familiar with Mexican history, he was a dictator who ruled Mexico for decades with an iron hand. He brought stability and economic progress, which was good, but you did not want to cross him.
That's exactly what she did. She ended up having to flee Mexico for protesting the arrest of a local journalist because he had criticized the dictatorship of Diaz.
Wow, facing Porfirio Diaz head on. Well, she was truly fearless.
Bly left the Dispatch in 1887 as she was dissatisfied with being regularly assigned to write women's columns. She went to New York City, where she was eventually discovered by Joseph Pulitzer's New York World.
Joseph Pulitzer, well, that is a famous name. He's the one who created the famous prizes in journalism and history. He is a legend in the world of journalism.
Her first assignment? Covering the conditions at the Women's Lunatic Asylum on Blackwell's Island. The island, known today as Roosevelt Island, is now a national park, and the asylum is in ruins.
Well, that was an unusual assignment, but it's in keeping with the times. We are smack in the middle of the progressive era, after all. Muckraking journalists, as they were called, liked to explore all aspects of America's modern industrial society in the late 19th century, even its less savory aspects. A person like Jacob Riis, for example, made a name for himself visiting the tenement houses of New York City.
The assignment had a further twist, though. Rather than going openly as a reporter, Bly was supposed to get herself declared insane and admitted to Blackwell's.
So how did she pull it off?
In order to pass for insane, Bly decided the best thing would be to stay up all night so she looked disheveled and check herself into a ladies' boarding house where no one knew her.
Wow, I know that look, disheveled. I have seen students pull up all-nighters before the exam and, well, let's put it this way, they do not look too good at 8 a.m.
Nellie Bly figured that the hardest part would be tricking doctors into believing she was insane. She pulled it off by having a faraway look in her eyes, by repeatedly claiming that the other boarders were insane, and by continuing to stay up all night. However, she found it more difficult to convince the women at the boarding house.
Why would it be easier to fool trained doctors into believing her insanity act than other working-class women who had no medical training?
Because late 19th century doctors understood little about diagnosing and treating mental illness. They knew even less about women's health, as they thought hysteria was caused by a wandering uterus. But the women at the boarding house told the local police that there was something suspicious about her behavior.
Uh-oh, so she was found out after all. So what happened to Bly after the women reported her to the police?
She was brought to a police station where a judge was left to determine what should be done with her. The court had a doctor examine her.
And so, surely, the doctor did not believe her act, right?
He ended up confirming it. The exam was a farce. The doctor examined her tongue, her pulse, and her eyes. He concluded that she was either using belladonna, which Bly denied, or that she was truly insane. Bly had no problem convincing all her doctors after that.
So, after she was declared officially insane, what happened to her then?
She was brought by boat to Blackwell's. The main theme throughout Bly's experiences was the filthiness of hospitals intended to care for mentally ill patients. The wards were drafty, the food was terrible, and the clothing provided was not decent quality. When Bly commented on the conditions and asked for better treatment, she was told that she should be thankful for what she gets and that you need not expect any kindness here, for you won't get it.
Please, sir, can I have some more? That sounds like a Charles Dickens novel. And I thought this was supposed to be a hospital in the modern United States during the Progressive Era.
That's what Bly thought before she started this assignment. Bly later described the place as a human rat trap. It is easy to get in, but once there, it is impossible to get out.
So what did the staff at the hospital do since they were not caring truly for their patients?
The nurses would physically and mentally abuse them. Fortunately for Bly, she was considered to be nonviolent. Otherwise, she would have been abused in an unspeakable manner. One woman who had spent time in the violent ward told Bly that she'd been beaten with a broom handle, jumped on top of by the nurses, half drowned in a tub of freezing water, and her hair ripped out.
Well, this show has taken a dark turn all of a sudden. That is horrific. Well, still, tell us more about the daily life of Nellie Bly when she was there.
Well, the food was frequently spoiled and mostly without any salt. Once, Nellie Bly found a spider that had been baked into the loaf of bread like a raisin, served the patients. Meanwhile, the nurses and doctors ate very well. The patients were used for free janitorial services, and they were allowed to go outside once a day before lunch, but were not allowed to set foot on the well-kept grounds at Blackwell's. Bathing was disgusting, considering the same freezing cold water was used for each person until it could no longer be used.
Wow, how did anyone even manage to stay alive there, let alone remain sane?
Bly often wondered the same thing, especially considering, when not doing their other activities or being actively abused, the women were forced to sit on hard, straight benches perfectly still for sometimes hours with absolutely nothing to do. Bly commented, 2 months of this treatment would make her, any woman, a mental and physical wreck.
Was there any purpose in the nurses forcing the women to do this, or was it just more abuse?
It was probably a bit of both, as they wanted to keep the women out of their hair for a while. Also, the rest cure was a popular treatment prescribed to mainly middle-class women in the 19th century. Basically, people on rest cure did nothing and tried to stay in bed as much as possible.
So did it actually cure anything?
Apparently not, or at least it certainly did not in Charlotte Perkins Gilman's case. She was a 19th century woman put on a rest cure. Her short story, The Yellow Wallpaper, dramatizes this experience, and by the end of the story, she is fully hallucinating.
So much for the cure part.
Back to Bly. She probably would have never gotten out of the asylum if she could not prove her sanity once in there.
Well, that's a scary thought, because, I mean, she faked her way into the asylum just for that one assignment, and now she was at risk of spending the rest of her life in the asylum from hell. So how did she manage to get out?
She was released after 10 days of hell, only because her newspaper managed to get her out. Bly then compiled her exposé, and soon afterward traveled back to Blackwell's with a grand jury formed to investigate what Bly had found there.
Let me guess, the asylum staff hid the evidence of the abuse.
Yes, when Bly went back, the conditions had been suspiciously cleaned up, and no 2 nurses could give the same testimony. Bly and the rest of the world had been under the impression that asylums were meant to care for the mentally ill. Instead, Bly found women like herself who were not insane, but were declared so by doctors who had no idea how to determine sanity. It seems that any woman who was perceived as different by society and lacked the resources to provide themselves better options could be declared insane.
You may have a point there. As I told you earlier, I once had a student who did her senior thesis on Nellie Bly and the world of insane asylums in the late 19th century. And oftentimes, women who were committed to asylums were committed there simply because they were rabble-rousers, because they did not fit the norm of society at the time, or in some cases because their husbands thought that these wives were not obedient enough. So the asylums were an instrument of social control, not mental health. But we've been talking for a while, so now would be a good time to listen to our next song. What do you have in store for us?
Basket Case by Postmodern Jukebox.
Do you have the time to listen to me whine about nothing and everything all at once? I am one of those melodramatic fools, sometimes I give myself the creeps. Sometimes my mind plays tricks on me. It all keeps adding up. I think I'm cracking up. Am I just paranoid? to a shrink to analyze my dreams. Who said my life's a bore? So stop your whining, cause it's bringing me down. Oh, 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 oh. Sometimes I give myself the creeps. Sometimes my mind plays tricks on me. It all keeps adding up. I think I'm cracking up. Am I just paranoid? Or am I just stoned? Oh, ooh, 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 grasping to contrast. So I better hold on. I give myself the creeps, oh yes I do, I really do. Sometimes my mind plays tricks on me. It all keeps adding up. I think I'm cracking up. Am I just paranoid? I might be paranoid. Am I just paranoid? Or am I just stoned?
Listening to Your Grandma Rocks on KBYS. I'm Sarah.
Et je suis Philippe Girard. We just listened to Basket Case by Postmodern Jukebox. Today we are retracing the life of Nellie Bly. She was a muck-raking investigative journalist who made a name for herself investigating the world of insane asylums for the famous newspaper run by Joseph Pulitzer. Okay, now we need to talk about her trip around the world. I was a huge fan of novels by Jules Verne, or Jules Verne in French, back when I was a kid, including the one about going around the world in 80 days.
Bly's expose of Blackwell's is what made her into a famous investigative journalist. But yes, perhaps she is best remembered for her 1889 80-day trip around the world to turn the novel Around the World in 80 Days into a real event.
I need to ask, so how long did she take? 80 days, like in the novel?
Bly was able to circumnavigate the globe in 72 days, thus setting a world record, although it only stood for a few months.
As I recall, she even had the time to make a little stop in the city of Amiens, which is a city where Jules Verne lived, so that she could say hello to him on the way. It was really incredible that she was able to beat the time in the book by Jules Verne, considering that world transportation was not the greatest yet.
Following this, Bly decided to step back from reporting and became a novelist for a while, writing 11 novels between 1889 and 1895.
Are these novels any good?
They were quite successful and made her a lot of money, so I assume so. But they were published in the press, not in book form, and were lost for a century. They were just recently rediscovered a couple years ago.
Well, that's a shame. So what did she do after 1895?
She married a millionaire named Robert Seaman, the head of Ironclad Manufacturing Company.
That's interesting. After all this life of adventure, I would have thought that she would have chosen to remain single and independent, rather than going for the traditional homemaker role that she had once denounced. So how old was she when she got married?
She was 31, and he was 73.
Wow, that is quite the May-November romance there. More than 40 years difference.
Actually, they weren't married for long. After he died in 1904, Bly inherited the company.
That's just me talking, but I wonder if that was part of the plan all along. You know, marrying an old man and then cashing in after a few years. Again, just me talking.
She did more than just cash the checks. She also ran the company. She invented a couple of things for which she received patents.
What were those patents for?
A milk can and a stacking garbage can.
So until Nellie Bly, no one had thought of stacking their trash cans?
Not exactly. It was a new style of metal garbage can that was made to stack inside of each other.
All right, very smart then. So how did she do as CEO of the company after her husband's death?
Bly was good at developing policies intended to benefit her factory workers.
Well, that makes sense. She was a progressive, remember?
But she was not as good at running a business. The company went bankrupt.
That's a bit ironical. Progressives often criticize robber barons like Rockefeller or Vanderbilt for not paying their workers enough or not treating them well enough. But then I guess she discovered the hard way that being too nice to her workers was no way to run a business. So what did she do then?
So she returned to journalism and continued to be a hands-on reporter by covering the women's suffrage procession of 1913.
Well, that is true. Women did not have the right to vote yet. That only happened in 1920 in the U.S.
Then she covered Europe's Eastern Front during World War I.
Well, that's a scary assignment. She was fearless, as always.
She was even mistaken for a British spy, but she was later released.
Well, now might be the time to plug another show I did for KBYS. There's one about Gertrude Bell, who was an actual British spy during World War I, and a history major, by the way. Nellie Bly really seems to have had a million lives. So what did she do next?
Well, not much, actually. After a remarkable life of 57 years, Nellie Bly died of pneumonia in New York City in 1922.
Oh, that's sad. Her story really came to an abrupt end.
She certainly disproved throughout her life the article What Girls Are Good For and the stereotypes that women should be only homemakers and mothers.
That is for sure. She was a journalist. She went undercover in an insane asylum. She traveled around the world in less than 80 days. She was a novelist, an industrialist, a wife at some point, an inventor as well, maybe even supposedly a spy. Well, that was quite the life.
We are glad that we could share this with you and hope you found it to be insightful.
Quelle vie incroyable en effet. Well, thank you, Sarah. That was an interesting story. We'll finish with a quick word about our sponsors, please.
This program was founded by a Juliet Hardner Grant for Women in the Humanities.
And it was also sponsored by the History Department at McNeese. Sarah is a student there. And if you want to apply for a degree in history or any other field, contact the McNeese Admissions Office, 337-475-5504.
We'll have to leave you there. Thank you and goodbye.
Merci. Au revoir.
Hey, don't write yourself off yet. It's only in your head you feel left out or looked down on. Just try your best. Try everything you can. It doesn't matter what they tell themselves when you're away. It just takes some time. Little girl, you're in the middle of the ride. Everything will be just fine. Everything will be alright. It just takes some time. Little girl, you're in the middle of the ride. Everything will be just fine. Everything will be alright. Hey, you know they're all the same. You know you do it better on your own, so don't buy it. It doesn't matter if that's good enough for someone else. It just takes some time. Little girl, you're in the middle of the ride. Everything will be just fine. Everything will be alright, alright. It just takes some time. Little girl, you're in the middle. Everything will be just fine. Everything will be alright, alright.